guys. Lee Bratcher, the president of the Texas Blockchain Council. We are here at the Texas Capitol during Consensus, interviewing thought leaders and basically pioneers in the space. And we're fortunate to have Kevin Zhang with us today. Kevin's one of the OGs in the space, known by most, if not all, people in the Bitcoin mining space. So we're going to talk about his background, a little bit about Foundry, some of their products and what they're doing, how they became the largest mining pool in the world. So it's going to be a fun conversation. But Kevin, start out with a little bit of your background and how'd you get into mining Bitcoin?
Yeah, sure. Well, thanks for having me first. It's always great visiting Texas again. Love the state. So my background on Bitcoin mining started through video games, right? So I was a very avid video gamer growing up and got really knee deep into World of Warcraft. And within the game, they had digital currencies called WoW Gold. And that kind of taught me very early on the value of digital currencies. And from some of my friends I played online with, one of them actually grew up with Roger Ver.
Wow.
Childhood friends. And he was looking to build a Bitcoin mining facility in California in 2013, all right? And the whole market was crashing. A lot of the Western manufacturers of ASICs had crashed. So the only ones left standing were the Bitmains and Canons of the world. So he needed someone to speak Chinese, do international business with them, and help them grow their mining farm from the international business standpoint. Wow. So I got sucked in early.
Wow, that's exciting.
Yeah.
And Bitmain has just crushed it since then. They're dominating the market. They're producing quality machines. And they seem to just continue to get better.
Right. Well, it's fascinating to see kind of the growth of kind of the whole industry.
Yeah.
But it's really the people that have survived a lot of these downturns, these rough cycles.
Sure.
Bitmain's had their bumps along the road.
Yeah.
But they've been able to stay competitive and kind of survive longer than others. And because of that, they now have a lot of market dominance.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about pools.
Sure.
And the achievement, recent achievement of Foundry becoming the largest Bitcoin mining pool in the world.
Yeah.
Was that a goal that y'all set out to do or just happened?
Obviously, we knew that if we're going to make a mining pool, it had to be a top five mining pool.
Yeah.
Right. Because there's a lot of luck volatility that goes into it. So if you don't hit critical mass, you're not going to survive the luck volatilities. If you go on a very bad luck streak, you can very easily go out of business. So we were just trying to crack the top five when we first set out to build a pool. And this was a little over 2 years ago.
Yeah.
So this was summer of 2020. And I think hitting number one, I think that was beyond our wildest dreams. We knew it was possible, but we didn't think we'd hit it this fast. Mining side as well. It's all innovation within Bitcoin, within blockchain space, everything, right?
Right.
A lot of the, there's a massive brain drain. Like a lot of it's flocked over to Singapore, to other parts of the world, like North America once again. They really did fumble it, if we're continuing to use sports analogies, right?
I love a good sports analogy. So.
That's right.
So tell me a little bit more about Foundry's products and what you're offering to miners. There's a lot of creative things that are sort of at the precipice of adoption. And I think this, as this industry becomes more institutionalized, there's some interesting things to think through.
Sure. So a little bit of background on Foundry. We're a wholly owned subsidiary of Digital Currency Group. And DCG and us, our focus has always been on bringing institutional adoption to the digital asset space. Our focus and my focus at Foundry is on the Bitcoin mining side.
Yeah.
So at Foundry, we are kind of split down the middle. Half our company is focused on Bitcoin mining, proof of work. The other half is focused on staking.
Yeah.
But for our discussions, we'll focus on the mining side of it.
Yeah.
So part of bringing adoption to North America and institutional adoption is breaking down a couple narratives. When we first set out to grow mining in North America, we're tackling the narrative one, Bitcoin, so much of the pool hash rate was concentrated there. All the manufacturing, a lot of the facilities were all operating there. And the next narrative was kind of on the environmental side, right? With the ESG concerns, with the energy consumption, et cetera. So we realized that to help at least alleviate the centralization point of it, we wanted to bring up services that are offered here domestically in the US. So the first way we kind of broke into that was through equipment financing. It's ASIC-backed financing loans.
Yeah.
And we wanted to inject capital in the space when no one else was willing to invest in it. So this was early 2020. We had the COVID crashes, and we were just a few months away from the halving. No one was putting money into the mining space, but we wanted to be contrarian. And we knew that to really drive this industry to the next stage, we want to take that risk, and we want to kind of support the cash flow and equity in the space. So we bought a lot of miners and we started financing miners in a big way. And that's what also led to our proprietary mining. Because at that time, mining economics were so dire, not everyone was taking us up on financing. So we had some financing deals, but we also had a lot of machines we had to deploy out of our own. So we became a very large self-miner in 2020 as well.
Yeah.
And that helped us decentralize the market from getting physical machines here, but on the virtual side, on the mining pool side, on the software layer, if you're building all these facilities and getting miners here and then redirecting all the virtual hash rate, so then we knew we needed to build a mining pool. So that's equipment financing, self-mining, and the mining pool. And then from there, we also launched advisory services, right? People that are institutional oil and gas companies, private equity firms, hedge funds, nation states, sovereign wealth funds that have capital but don't know how to navigate our tricky landscape, we're willing to advise them and help them kind of on their journey to becoming a successful miner. So we launched advisory services. And then more recently, we launched FoundryX, which is a trading desk, a marketplace for buying and selling ASICs, to making that a little bit more efficient, more fluid, and having a trusted counterparty for procuring or selling your equipment. And that's evolved too to now include logistics. So we're a one-stop shop for all things financial services, just short of creating the equipment itself.
Wow. Very cool. As ASICs become more commoditized, do you foresee with oil, we have West Texas Intermediate, right? It's a commodity. There's a location. There's a price. It's set based upon that geography. There's also the London price. I can't remember the name of it, but there's different jurisdictions in the world that have this. Bitcoin cannot be commoditized in the same way because of the decentralized nature of it. But ASICs are physical.
Yeah.
Do you foresee some greater commoditization of Bitcoin mining ASICs, or is that something that is it's also too decentralized?
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting topic and discussion. There's definitely different theories and game theories at play. I would say over time, yes, long term, I think things are becoming more mature of an industry and it is becoming more institutionalized, right?
Yeah.
Now it's the larger publicly listed miners that are getting all the ASIC equipment. And I think the manufacturers themselves are becoming a little bit more mature as well. The quality of their products are maturing. And I think the dollars per terahash or hash price index of what you're looking at buying your equipment for, and how much they're paying in return, that's being normalized over time, right? I think the lifespan of the units are lasting longer too. When I first started mining, you were expecting, you're hoping the machine would last longer than 3 months, right? And then there would be a new generation to come out. The ASICs just got, the tech nodes on them just got smaller and smaller and smaller because they're still catching up with modern technology.
Yeah.
But now the ASIC technology, they're pushing for capacity allocation along with the Apples and the Samsungs of the world, right? So it's the same chip sizes and tech nodes. That's really matured. And I think to further kind of drive this discussion, not only do I think the ASICs will commoditize over time, I think it's going to be the Bitcoin mining space will be intertwined with energy and large public energy markets and companies, right? One of the kind of holy grail discussions we always talked about on online forums in the early days of Bitcoin mining was who's the lowest cost competitor for electricity?
Yeah.
They need to be the Bitcoin miners. And so anyone that's
behind, generator.
Exactly, generator, behind the meter, generating their own electricity, it makes sense that they control their own destiny. They have the cheapest access to power. They're going to be the most competitive miner. It's taken a long time for the industry to get to that point, because I think a lot of us crypto anarchists from the earlier days, we underestimated convincing a room full of conservative board members and traditional private equity firms and those type of investors that one Bitcoin is the real deal.
Yeah.
It's here for the long term. But we're starting to see more and more behind the meter and large energy companies getting into space, especially here in this great state.
Yeah, I've got a running bet with several people about which will be the first generator to acquire a Bitcoin mining company.
Yeah.
So my money's on Vistra. Remains to be seen.
It's a good bet.
Other people have said like Shell or NRG, you know, other generators or oil majors, you know, there's kind of throw them in the loop too. So, well, where can people go to find out more about you and about Foundry and the work that you guys are doing?
Sure. So our website is foundrydigital.com. You can come visit us anytime online, reach out to us. We also attend all the major Bitcoin and Bitcoin mining events, right? So we're here in a big way here at Consensus.
Yeah.
We're also going to be going to Mining Disrupt in Miami in a couple months. And it's never hesitate to reach out to us, whether it's on social media, on Twitter, LinkedIn. We're pretty active on there as well.
And hopefully coming to our summit in November.
Oh, absolutely.
It has a very strong Bitcoin mining flavor.
Yeah, and I have to thank you for that, because I know I was talking to you about this last night. Thanks for the invite last year. We've been back multiple times since then, enjoying the local barbecue, but I love seeing all the growth and opportunities here in Texas.
Yeah, wonderful. Kevin, thanks for taking the time to be here and enjoy Consensus.
Yeah, thanks for having me.